going to be talking about the relational model. Some of it will be somewhat technical. For those of you who are technical, you hopefully appreciate this. For those of you who are not technical, I apologize in advance. I'll try to provide some explanations of what I'm showing you. So that'll be the first part, and then the second part, I'll do a bit of a demo of the piece of software that I'm going to be talking about here. Well, without further ado, this is about the true relational model for desktop data processing. About 2 weeks ago, this talk wouldn't have existed. It would have just been REL, the true relational model. As of about a week ago, I released some new features in the piece of software that I'm going to be talking about that have kind of changed its focus and changed its capability, I think, in a very positive way. It makes it quite practically useful for certain tasks. And that's partly what I'm going to be showing you today. So not only is it an alternative to SQL, as it's subtitled here, but it's also perhaps becoming an alternative for the sort of work that we traditionally do, or certain kinds of work that we traditionally do using Excel spreadsheets, for better or for worse. And this, I think, in some respects, provides an easier way of doing certain things. There's also another subtitle. I initially called it REL for desktop data crunching, which is really very different from what most of you have been looking at all week, which is about analytics. This really isn't about analytics per se. There's no analytics component here, and there isn't really meant to be an analytics component. It's really about preparing data, perhaps for the analytics or other purposes that you'll put the data to afterwards. So let's talk about that. In fact, let's first talk just a little bit about data in general. And if we look at data, we look at sort of four fundamental things that we do with data. We present it, process it and analyze it and produce presentations of it. That's what a lot of you are interested in. We also store and retrieve it, and of course we stream it. We collect it, perhaps from devices or perhaps from human input. And these all have some fundamental relationships between them. We might stream data from devices and then store it for later retrieval. We might stream it directly to various analytical processing devices. We might process it somewhat and then store the result of the processing, and so on. The area that I'm going to focus on mainly, and I'll talk about that in a minute, is the storage and retrieval side. Storage and retrieval, we usually think, perhaps simplistically, of storing it into files and retrieving it from files, and we will probably always be doing that in some way, shape, or form or another. But we also abstract away the low-level file access into various higher-level conceptual mechanisms, such as what we call relational database systems, or what we call logic-based database systems, which are very closely related to relational systems. And of increasing popularity these days, we have what we call NoSQL database systems, an alternative to the classic SQL, which, if you haven't used it, you're at least probably peripherally familiar with it. Ultimately, all of these things, basically, as I mentioned, are ways of abstracting away access to files. Files are low-level, rather tedious to work with, so we provide higher-level mechanisms, and the files themselves tend to be collected in groups on things that we call file systems that organize files in some way, and then file systems themselves are stored on physical media, data storage mechanisms, storage media, hard disks, USB drives, that sort of thing. Of course, streaming receives its data or is a collection of data sources like Internet of Things, or even just a simple manual data entry. Something I haven't really shown here are some other aspects related to data, like governance and security and data management. I'm not really going to talk about those today, because really what I'm talking about is the technical side of data science, not the managerial side, not the conceptual side, but really the technical side of data science. And as I mentioned earlier, the part that's of particular interest to me is really the storage and retrieval side and the abstraction side. How do we store and retrieve data, and how do we represent that data to make it easy for us to manipulate that data? So that storage and retrieval is really what we're going to be talking about. And as I mentioned, we have various ways to do that. We have files, we have the category, the growing category of NoSQL systems. We have logic-based systems, which outside of the academic world we tend not to talk about much, and we have relational database systems, which we tend to talk about a lot. And if we were to assign attributes to these, we note that one of the big benefits of relational database systems is that they provide provable query optimization. In other words, if we want to retrieve data, we can automate that retrieval of data, and we can automate the optimization of the retrieval of data so that it occurs efficiently and rapidly. And the relational model, which I'll talk about more in a minute, provides the fundamental theory that makes that possible. Logic-based systems, which you may not have heard of much, also provide provable query optimization. Relational database systems provide a very intuitive model of data. Relational systems represent data typically in grid structures. We often call them tables because they're a tabular structure. Logic-based systems are an alternative to that. They represent data storage in terms of predicates and rules. Unfortunately, predicates and rules might be intuitive if you're a logician or a mathematician, but perhaps not as intuitive for someone who just wants to store and retrieve data and not think about the theoretical aspects. NoSQL systems also tend to provide a very intuitive model. Their model tends to be store a piece of data today, and you can get it back tomorrow. That tends to be pretty simple. Put in a piece of data, identify it with a key perhaps, use the key to get back a piece of data. But unfortunately, because they don't have the same sort of theoretical underpinning as logic-based systems and relational systems, query optimization is generally up to the user or the programmer who builds the system. So that's kind of a limitation. And finally, files, as I mentioned, these other three approaches abstract away what are really complicated and tend to be very simplistic ways of manipulating data. In fact, the semantics of manipulating files tend to be, you can open a file, you can close a file, you can read a piece of a file, and you can write a piece of a file, but that tends to be about it. That's a very low-level way of working with data. So the focus here is going to be on the relational abstraction of data manipulation, this tabular model of data, along with the ability to prove that queries can be optimized, can be made most efficient. So that's what the focus will be on, is relational systems. And I should emphasize here that when we're talking about relational systems, we're really talking about structured data. There's obviously a role in the data processing and analytics world for dealing with unstructured data, freeform text and the like, which we've seen today. That's a different world. That's largely part of the NoSQL world, and that's a good world, but it's not what I'm going to talk about today. A big proportion of the data we deal with is and probably will always be structured data, data that we've identified what the kinds of data are and we've labeled them. When we're talking about relational systems, the usual things that come to mind, well, the usual thing that comes to mind is SQL, a database query language. That's what we usually think about. But that's not necessarily the only way of viewing or manipulating data. In fact, if we look back over history, there have been a lot of different ways of storing and retrieving data. We have hierarchical databases, we have network databases, we have something called multi-value databases, and we have these logic-based systems called deductive databases. All of these four things are largely, or were until recently, largely considered historical ways of dealing with data. In a lot of ways, they would have been, at least until recently, considered obsolete. In fact, hierarchical databases, there's still some popular forms of these. There's a mainframe system called IMS, still sold by IBM, still a big proportion of its revenue. We have things like lightweight directory access protocol. It's probably used in every major enterprise system to store things like passwords and machine information, and even something called Windows Registry that stores information about applications. These are modern uses of hierarchical databases. But in terms of day-to-day data management, they're largely replaced by SQL. Network databases, once very popular in the 60s, largely replaced by SQL in the 1980s. Multi-value databases, something called PIC, was probably the best-known example for many years, largely replaced by SQL. In fact, just out of curiosity, how many people here have heard of PIC? No hand. Oh, one. One. Yeah, fair enough. Largely unknown. Now, deductive databases in the theoretical world, people who work in databases in the academic side have probably heard of something called Datalog, which is based on a language called Prolog. But how many people have heard of Datalog? One. Yes, indeed. Most of these have just, the table has been swept clean and left SQL, except for its alternative, NoSQL. These are kind of a dog's breakfast of systems. Some of them are network systems, some of them are hierarchical, some of them are what are called key value stores. You put in a value of some sort, some piece of data, you associate a key with it to retrieve it later by giving that key, and you get back the piece of data. We have things called column stores, we have unstructured data, all of these things fall under the category of NoSQL. Basically anything that isn't SQL gets called NoSQL, and indeed what tends to be the case is that NoSQL is really all of these old systems new again in a cool new package to make it seem appealing. So some of these old ideas are now new again, and we call them NoSQL. But even though NoSQL gets a lot of media attention and there's a lot of talk about it and a lot of talk about software based around it, in the enterprise world at least, and in much of the data processing world, SQL still dominates. If we're talking about databases, most of the time we're going to be talking about SQL based databases. SQL dominates. And yet, I want you to look at this quote. This quote is interesting. This was by a notable figure who said, in the near future, we can expect a great variety of languages to be proposed for interrogating and updating databases. That was written by E.F. Ted Codd in 1972. Well, who is E.F. Ted Codd? Is no less than the individual IBM researcher who in 1970 discovered or invented, depending on your point of view, the relational model that is the inspiration for modern SQL databases. He is the father of modern relational databases. He is arguably the father of SQL, and yet he said, in the near future, not long after he discovered the relational model, we expect there to be a plethora of database languages. We expect there to be a lot of them. And indeed, if we look at the programming world, it's full of languages. I've just listed languages here that at some point I've had something to do with. This is just a tiny, tiny slice of a vast programming world, a vast proliferation of programming languages. There are probably hundreds of thousands of programming languages. There's a pretty wide set of popular ones, but if you look at the whole programming world, there are hundreds of thousands of languages that even today are in active use. And yet if we look at the database world, let's count the number of popular languages in the database world. Get ready to count them. One. SQL. One. Well, almost only one relational database language. Just one. And maybe that's not a bad thing. I mean, if you talk to a student learning computer programming, they're probably overwhelmed by the number of programming languages. Probably every programming language student has said at some point, why are there all these languages? Why don't we have just one like the database world? They've just got one. Isn't that good that we have only one language we have to learn? Except it isn't really just one. There is an SQL standard, and almost none of the SQL vendors, and there are many, follow that standard. In fact, every implementation of SQL is slightly different. Every implementation of Java is Java. Every implementation of Prolog is Prolog. Every implementation of C# is C#. Every implementation of SQL is a different language. They all belong to the same family, but they're all slightly different. So it's supposed to be standardized, and yet it isn't. That's not good. That's not good. And I suppose we wouldn't mind. We'd happily put up with that if SQL was a great language. But it isn't a great language. It's a terrible language. In fact, if you talk to people who work in the industry using SQL databases day in and day out, probably their number one complaint is about the quirks and difficulties and annoyances of the SQL dialect that they have to use on a daily basis. It's full of flaws. I'm not going to go through all of those. That's just a starting list of some of the flaws. The list goes on and on. Notice the etc. in red down at the bottom. If I wanted to, I could easily come up with another 20 or 30 slides listing all the hideous flaws in this one language that all of us in the conventional database world are forced to use. Is it no wonder then that there's all of this talk about no SQL, an alternative to SQL? No wonder, given all of those problems. But you know what? Even this list, which I could expand endlessly, that isn't the biggest flaw. The relational model, invented in 1970 by E.F. Ted Codd, that is the inspiration for SQL, is not implemented faithfully by SQL. Even though we call SQL a relational language, a relational database language, it doesn't actually implement what the relational model, as set down by E.F. Ted Codd, said. There are differences, significant, fundamental, foundational differences between SQL and the actual relational model. For example, SQL has something called null. Null is used to represent missing values. Everybody who works with relational SQL databases deals with null. And it doesn't work very well. It introduces something called three-value logic. Boolean logic has two values, true and false, nothing else. That's it, true and false. That makes it very simple. As soon as you introduce null to it, you have three-valued logic. Every logic table now suddenly expands because you have to take into account null. That represents complexity. When we bring that into SQL, not only does that introduce complexity, it introduces confusion. And I'll show you how in a moment or two. The true relational model says that's not how to represent missing values. There are other ways to represent missing values, and they're better. They may introduce a bit more complexity in terms of data modeling, in terms of how you represent data, but they're logically consistent. That actually makes things simpler. Even though they're slightly more complex in terms of what you need to do, they're actually conceptually simpler. SQL also allows duplicate rows in a table. Logically, that's like asserting the same fact over and over and over again. Why would you assert the same fact twice? Why would you assert the same fact 10 times? That's meaningless. In the relational model, it says there's no such thing as a duplicate row. Assert each fact once, and only once. In certain SQL implementations, you can actually have duplicate columns. You can have a column in a table called name, and it has student names, and you can have another column in the table called name, and it represents staff names. Not every implementation does that, but some do, and that's a source of confusion. The relational model says attribute names, same as column names, cannot exist. They can only be unique. In SQL, the order of columns is significant. That makes programming hard. That makes working with SQL hard. In the true relational model, there's no notion of order. The order of things doesn't matter. You reference them by name, not by some ordered position. And indeed, this leads us to talk about language design, because really we're talking about SQL as a model that deviates from the relational model and the relational model itself. If we look at SQL as a language, the flaws of SQL as a model lead to flaws in the language, like a limited type system, like an awkward and archaic syntax full of inconsistencies and lack of symmetry and limited support for constraints. Yet, if we had languages that were truly compatible with the relational model, we should be able to have very rich type systems that represent complex data types and yet manipulate them logically. We should be able to have languages that demonstrate good language design, unlike SQL's appalling language design. And we should be able to have extensive support for database constraints. I'm not going to go into details about why these things are so. I'll just ask you to trust me at this point that if we were faithful to the relational model, we can build powerful languages. If we're not faithful to the relational model, we wind up with poor languages like SQL. So that raises an obvious question. Obvious question is, well, what went wrong? If E.F. Ted Codd said, here's the relational model and it's good, what happened to it? What went wrong? Where did it go? Let's look to history for an answer to that question. So here's a brief history of SQL and true relational database languages over time. First, let's look at what's almost prehistory in IT terms. Before 1968 or so, we had a primordial ooze of ad hoc systems, mostly hierarchical and network databases, mostly built as kind of one-off systems. And in 1970, it was E.F. Ted Codd at IBM that took a look at that prehistory and said, this is a mess. This doesn't work well. We can do better than this. And he wrote what is probably one of the best known papers in computer science, a relational model for large shared data banks. Pretty much every computer science student is going to see that paper at some point in their undergraduate career, probably when they go on to further education as well. That was the starting point to a revolution that went wrong. In between 1970 and 1972, IBM, inspired by Ted Codd's paper, developed a prototype based on the relational model called IS-1, developed in Peterlee in the UK, somewhere up north, I don't know where that is, but somewhere up there. It wasn't really a database management system as we currently know it. It was largely a test bed. Now, inspired by the same paper, just shortly after the development of the IS-1 testbed, IBM in the USA developed a prototype inspired by the relational model but deviating from it for reasons probably now lost to the dim mists of history that they called System R. And that was arguably the first implementation of something that we would recognizably describe as SQL. So not to be outdone by IBM US, IBM UK created a second prototype based on what they learned from IS-1 with a language called ISBL. It still wasn't really a database management system as we currently know it. It was largely designed to explore relational database concepts. But at least it was faithful to the relational model. That inspired a small company at the time called Oracle, or well, they became called Oracle, to, based on System R, create the first commercial version of SQL, something called the Oracle Database System. And they did very well at that, and they're still doing very well at that. And IBM then saw it, and it was good, and decided we can compete with that. We're going to come out with a product called SQLDS. And that was the second fully commercial SQL implementation designed to compete with the first commercial SQL implementation. Now, IBM still believed in the true relational model at this point and developed an IBM service bureau, I believe in the Netherlands, that implemented and deployed a language as a login service, a remote service that you connected to via terminals, based around a language called Business System 12. Business System 12, completely unlike SQL, was faithful to the relational model. Completely faithful to the relational model. And it did so well that they shut down the service bureau in 1985, 3 years later. And that was the end of Business System 12. At that point, that left SQL essentially uncontested. It grew at that point without bound into the 1980s. And oh, by the way, what happened to the IBM systems that faithfully implemented the relational model? Well, their original prototype, IS-1, was never released. It was just a prototype. PRTV, which actually could have turned into a commercial product, IBM decided internally, no, this will compete with our cash cow, IBM IMS, their mainframe network hierarchical database system, and they kept quiet about this relational model thing because they thought it would hurt IMS sales. And finally, the Service Bureau people were reluctantly moved over to SQL products. Apparently, they were really happy with Business System 12, but the Service Bureau is being shut down, so sorry folks, you're going to have to move. So what happened next? From 85 to about 1995, SQL basically ate the database world. In the background, we now started to hear about things called object-oriented databases. And indeed, that led to a number of significant papers and inventions. In 1989, we had something called the Object-Oriented Database System Manifesto. The idea being, take an object-oriented language, make the objects stick around after you turn the power off and come back when you turn the power on. That'll work. It turned out, no, it didn't. So the third generation database systems manifesto, written by some different people, said, okay, we're going to take SQL, which seems to be pretty popular, and we're going to take object-oriented stuff, and we're just going to back them into each other at high speed. The resulting system will hopefully be good, except it kind of wasn't. That led Hugh Darwen, who was one of the original developers of Business System 12, and Chris Date, familiar figure in the database world for writing textbooks on databases, to respond to these object-oriented manifestos with a design for a language that would be faithful to the relational model. And indeed, that was significant enough from an academic point of view that it propelled them to write two more books on the subject. All three of them roughly called the Third Manifesto as a subtitle and talking about various aspects of relational database design. We'll come back to that in a moment. That was sufficient to inspire other developments of the relational model. And indeed, there was even one that it turned out had been worked on at Northumbria University going back as far as 1991, used primarily as a teaching tool. And so by 2002-ish and onward, there were a number of attempts to create implementations of the true relational model, almost all of those inspired in one way or another by Dayton Darwin's writings. And their writings were significant because what they introduced were really two language designs. One is a language design for a language they called D, which has been somewhat retconned to mean Dayton Darwin's database dream, or just databases. That's basically any language that adheres to a set of principles for language design that were set down by Dayton Darwin. It doesn't describe language syntax, it describes language characteristics. And then they said, well, describing a language as a set of characteristics rather than a syntax isn't very clear. Let's make it clear what we mean. Let's create an example language design. And they called that Tutorial D. And they designed that primarily for illustration, to illustrate what the D language could be like. And they used that Tutorial D language as the basis for examples and illustrations in a number of textbooks. In fact, if you think back to the database courses you may have done in the past, probably Dates and Introduction to Database Systems was either the text you used, or at least it was mentioned at some point. If you look at a number of the non-SQL examples in it, those are written in Tutorial D. And in fact, a number of relationally inspired or relational database textbooks will use Tutorial D for examples. But as of 2003, there were no actual implementations of Tutorial D. You couldn't run it. It just lived on paper. It was examples in textbooks. So I made one. I decided, well, I'm teaching databases. Wouldn't it be nice if I could actually run some of these examples in the textbooks? And I called it REL for relational model. By the way, you'll notice that REL always shows in italics. That's because the italics are actually part of the name. REL without italics, not the name of the software. REL with italics, that's the name of the software. There's a bit of a tradition of that in the relational world. You'll notice that Tutorial D is always shown in bold. Tutorial D in bold is the language. Tutorial D not in bold isn't the language. So, okay, it's kind of silly, but that's what it is. I first released RHEL in 2004. That was the first release. In fact, not long after I started here, I released it. I'm still working on it. I've been working on it fairly steadily as kind of a spare time activity ever since. And of course, you can download it. It's available online at reldb.org. It's open source. All of the source is available for you to play with, because I also use it as an illustration of language design and language implementation in modules not related to databases. It's cross-platform. At least the user interface is cross-platform to the extent of running equivalently on Windows, OS X, and on Linux. There's also a standalone database management system that the user interface can connect to that runs anywhere Java will run, which is all sorts of different platforms. Probably means it'll even run on an Android phone, though I haven't tried it. So, RHEL, let's talk about RHEL. This is all leading up to actually doing some illustrations of what it can do. RHEL is basically a database management system, just like MySQL or PostgreSQL or any other. It's specifically primarily intended for teaching purposes. It's a pedagogical tool rather than a production tool. It's also been used and is being used for various research activities into the true relational model. There are people who have based PhD theses around it. And it's also a tool for developing a growing body of empirical evidence that the uncompromised, true, faithful relational model actually does work. That it can do all the same kind of things that you would do in a database management system based on SQL, but hopefully does it a little bit better. It's also, RHEL is really two things. It's two products in one box. One hand, it's the database management system that maintains databases and implements the tutorial D database language, but it's also got a user-friendly, or fairly user-friendly, it's quite technical, database front end, which is designed to allow you to easily create and administer and manage RHEL databases. The idea of that is that it provides evidence that end users can actually work with the uncompromised relational model as well. So the database management system gives us evidence that the fundamental model works for a database management system. The user interface gives us evidence that end users can work with that effectively. As I mentioned, RHEL implements Tutorial D. Tutorial D is an interesting language because on one hand, it tends to be very verbose. It perhaps makes some of the same mistakes that SQL makes in terms of verbosity and being somewhat long-winded and having long keywords. But arguably, that makes it quite easy to learn and quite easy to understand. But at the same time, it has some quite advanced language features. It implements something called multiple dispatch, which if you're familiar with programming language design, you're probably thinking, oh, that's kind of cool. And if you're not familiar with programming language design, you're thinking, I have no idea what that is. That's fine. It provides something called multiple value representations. A given value, like a numeric value, can actually take on several representations, and I'll talk about that in a moment. It supports something called type inheritance, which is very similar to object-oriented programming's class inheritance. And indeed, you could argue that Tutorial D, I wouldn't say it's object-oriented, because that would be perhaps conflating it with some of the bad things of object-oriented languages, but some of the good things about object-oriented languages are also found in Tutorial D. And finally, because it is a relational language, the infamous relational algebra, the operators that allow us to manipulate relational databases, are exposed and accessible so that you can manipulate databases in terms of the relational algebra. So let me just give you a few really quick examples. I'm just going to rattle through these quickly because there's a point. I don't want you to look at the syntax here and pick it apart. The important thing to see from this is that for a lot of things in Tutorial D, it's similar enough to SQL syntax that if you're familiar with SQL, as most database people are, you'll pick up most of the tutorial D syntax very quickly. So creating a table in SQL and creating what is called a relation valued variable in tutorial D, very similar. An example here, inserting values into an SQL database uses the insert statement. Inserting values in tutorial D into a relation valued variable also uses an insert statement. Syntax is similar, not really that different at this point. Retrieving all of the rows and columns from a table in SQL, you use the infamous select statement. In tutorial D, somewhat simpler syntax. You just give the name of the variable and that retrieves everything in it. In SQL, we can retrieve all of the rows that have some characteristic, like a name equal to some value. In tutorial D, it's almost the same syntax. In SQL, we can select particular columns by naming them. In tutorial D, we can select particular columns by naming them. Again, very similar. The thing to take away from this is not the syntax, but the fact that, in a lot of ways, tutorial D syntax and SQL syntax are quite similar, at least from the point of view of being able to pick them up quickly and use them. Being able to summarize the contents of tables. Again, very simple, and a lot of similarities with SQL. Where we start to deviate are in some of the more complex things that we might want to do with a database language. If we want to create, for example, user-defined functions or user-defined operators, which we often want to do in a database language, we discover here's one of the problems where various vendors have deviated from the SQL standard. They all do things their own way. Tutorial D sets down a standard way of defining your own operators. The same for user-defined types, something we're very familiar with in programming languages, something we'd like to do in SQL, but tends to be very difficult and awkward. It turns out to be very easy in Tutorial D. And I mentioned before that Tutorial D has something that has no equivalent to SQL or really any other language, is that we have what are called multiple value representations. For example, and the example I use here is that of a temperature. If we're recording temperatures, we might want to record them as Celsius temperatures or Fahrenheit temperatures or Kelvin temperatures. But we want to manipulate them all as one consistent temperature type, despite the fact that we have different systems of measurement. Well, we can define types that contain the conversion mechanisms for converting from Celsius to Fahrenheit and Fahrenheit to Kelvin and Kelvin back to Celsius, and define that as part of the type. And then we can do something nice like define a table of temperature readings. And then we can take temperature readings in whatever measurement system we like. We can take Celsius readings or Fahrenheit readings or Kelvin readings. And then when we process them, we can tell the system that we want to treat them all as Celsius values. We don't have to explicitly perform a conversion, that's built into the type, and just say, yeah, look, we just want the Celsius, the temperatures in Celsius, and the Fahrenheit will get automatically converted to Celsius, and the Kelvin will get converted to Celsius, and then we manipulate them in Celsius. So that's quite a nice feature and unique to Tutorial D. A big issue that comes up every time you mention the fact that the true relational model doesn't implement null is someone immediately says, well, wait a minute, you've got to deal with missing data somehow, don't you? And that's true. Let's look at how we deal with it in SQL. In SQL, we might create a table of temperature readings, same as the one I created before, except this time the temperature is just a plain numeric type. And we might want to insert some temperatures into that table of temperatures. Here I've said the temperature is 34 degrees, here I've said the temperature is 38.2 degrees, and here I've said we don't know what the temperature is. It's null, it's a missing value. So if we want to select all of the temperature readings, that's how we'd say it in SQL. and we'd probably get back something like this table. We'd get back the IDs of the readings, we'd get back the temperatures, and we'd get back some sort of blank for the temperature where the temperature was entered as null. That seems very reasonable. And indeed, we might want to retrieve particular temperatures. We'd say select everything from temperature readings where the temperature is equal to 34.0, and we'd see that this SQL system happily returns ID 1 with temperature 34. So we know that temperature 34 has ID 1. So let's try that with null. Let's retrieve all of the rows that have no temperature reading, and we get back nothing at all. Well, yeah, that's kind of how SQL works. Null doesn't behave like regular values. That's one of these awkwardnesses. It's arguably a failing in the language. And indeed, there's arguably another failing. What does null tell us about that reading? It doesn't tell us why it's missing. It doesn't tell us how it came to pass that it's missing. It just tells us no value. And we can't deal with it consistently the same way we would normal values. How do we deal with that in tutorial D? Well, in tutorial D, I mentioned that handling nulls, I mentioned this early on, requires a bit more complexity. So I've decided here, but this is deliberate complexity, I've decided that my temperature readings can either consist of a numeric value, or they can consist of the fact that I've skipped the reading. Maybe they're supposed to occur every hour, and I missed an hour because I was away for lunch. Maybe I didn't read the temperature because the thermometer was broken. Maybe I didn't read the temperature for some reason I didn't think of, and I'll record it. This is a type that I've defined. The system doesn't define this. I define it as the programmer, and I can define types with arbitrary complexity. And now what I can do is when I record those temperatures, I can say ID number 1 has a temperature of 34, ID number 3 has a temperature of 38.2, and ID number 2 has a temperature of, oh, the thermometer was broken. And that goes into the database, which is fine. That's exactly what we want. And so I can now retrieve all of the temperature readings, and I will see that with ID 1, temperature reading was 34, and with ID 3, temperature reading was 38.2, and with ID 2, the thermometer was broken. No longer do I have this mysterious blank that is null. I've got a reason why there wasn't a temperature reading. And not only that, I can now retrieve all of the rows where the thermometer was broken. And it quite happily retrieves ID number 2 and tells me, yep, sure enough, that was retrieved because the thermometer was broken. Now instead of having this weird special null that fills in every time I've got a missing value, I can handle missing values in a logically consistent and end-user-friendly way. And that's what the real relational model gives me. The true relational model gives me is a way of representing missing data in an intuitive and consistent way instead of SQL's inconsistent and illogical way. So let's look at that. Does tutorial D actually tackle some of the flaws that I listed for SQL? I just listed a bunch of SQL flaws here, assorted ones, miscellaneous ones, and it looks like it pretty much does. I've gone through and analyzed this in some detail. There's some things that tutorial D doesn't do that SQL doesn't do either. That's one of them. And there's another one. User-defined aggregate operators is a common one that's leveled as a limitation of SQL. If you want to, for example, determine the sum of a set of values or the average of a set of values or the first or last of a set of values, that's built in. You want to determine the standard deviation of a set of values, you're probably going to have to write a custom aggregate function, if the SQL implementation allows it. Many don't. Tutorial D, as defined, didn't either, but I made a rel extension that fixes that. You can define your own aggregate functions. And so arguably that's now fixed as well. And this really is just a syntactic issue. So for every one of the SQL flaws that I listed early on, tutorial D and hence rel really tackles it. So let's look just briefly at the history of rel. I realize time is running out quickly, so I won't have time for much of a demo. up until 2016, the primary focus was on developing RHEL as a pedagogical tool. It was used to teach the relational model and not much else. It was a teaching tool, and that was it. As of late 2016, August 2016, I provided a very user-friendly front end and then postured it as something that you could use to create personal databases. And I have users that are using it that way. And it works well for that purpose. As of 2017, that being 6 days ago, I released a version that allowed you to connect easily to external data sources, CSV files, Excel files, Microsoft Access databases, ODBC/JDBC data sources in other SQL databases, and you can just plumb them in, treat them as variables within tutorial D inside of RHEL. And that, just a week ago, made actually a quite dramatic difference. What that allowed me to do was actually use it for practical purposes. And I will very quickly show you a few of those that I used it for in just a moment. One of the things that I also added is something that's turned out to be very powerful, a visual query language using an icons on strings approach. What's neat about that is you can define very complicated, rich queries, but debug them trivially by being able to evaluate sub-expressions within the query. And I realize I'm running out of time, but I'll try to show you an example of that. There's a lot of current work that I'm doing right now, and I'm also trying to get some students involved in this, which is to make the relational model more agile. One of the limitations of SQL databases is, once defined, they're not very flexible. I'm working on ways around that so that you retain all of the safety of the relational model and its rigorously defined schemas, but make them easy to change. I'm looking at ways of using RHEL as a wrapper around operating system facilities so that tutorial D can become a way to manipulate both operating system facilities and cloud resources. And I'm also looking at ways of refining the user interface to make it friendlier. And one of the goals there is, having recognized that being able to connect to external data sources and spreadsheets and so forth, suddenly that made it really easy to do things that used to be really difficult in Excel spreadsheets. We get a steady barrage of Excel spreadsheets for administrative purposes, containing data, we need to manipulate them, and we need to send Excel spreadsheets to other people. That tends to involve a lot of, well, desktop data crunching using Excel, and it's hard, and it's annoying, and it's error prone. It turns out that using RHEL, and I almost wouldn't have expected this, makes that kind of data crunching, that take in some external data, do some processing on it, and send it out as Excel to someone else, it turns out in RHEL that becomes really easy. And so that is going to be part of the future work. Is one of the things I'll be working on is perhaps a post-spreadsheet data sheet specifically designed to make it easy to do the things that are currently hard in Excel, but that we do in Excel anyway. I'll provide some references and so forth, but that's not the interesting part. They'll be available on the slides, which will be made available to you shortly. I'll just very quickly, in the few minutes that we have left, just show you quickly what RHEL looks like. I'll show you one of the things that I did with RHEL just the other day. I mean, this is literally last week I used it to do this, and I'll just load it up on the screen here. I won't go into a great deal of detail about how it works or how it looks. Suffice to say, the various tables of data are over here on the left. The job here was to take student lists for two different modules, combine those student lists for the two different modules, and assign those students to teams within a set of sessions that those students would be attending. So here are the computing students. I've obviously anonymized their names for the demonstration here. Here are students on another course that are actually going to be doing the same module. Here are the sessions that I need to assign those students to and the courses that those students will be on. Some courses, you will note, have more than one session. They need to be apportioned evenly to those courses. And what I did was I created a little script in Tutorial D that would allow me, first of all, to assign students to sessions. And in fact, I'll just run it here so that you can see it run. There, it's assigned all my students to the sessions they belong on. And then within each session, I need to break the students up into teams because it's a module called Team Project. So what I did was I defined how many teams, or sorry, what the size of the team should be for each session, and then I wrote a script in Tutorial D that'll do that for me. And I'll run it too. And there it goes, running away, assigning students to teams. Take just a moment. Okay, they're all assigned to teams. And now what I can do is see the results of that. There's all my students assigned to teams. And now, of course, I need to use that elsewhere. So I'll export that as Excel. And I'll just click there, and then I can export it. And I'll put that on my desktop. By the way, the source data for this came from Excel in the first place. These two variables are actually linked directly to the Excel spreadsheets that the source data came on. And then if we look here, there is the output from REL, basically ready to be sent to the students or used for whatever scheduling purposes I see fit. So there's the students assigned to the teams and assigned to the sessions. That work that I did to produce that database took me, I don't know, 20 minutes, a half hour, not working particularly quickly. Doing that same effort as I traditionally would have done it, either in Excel or by importing the data into something like Microsoft Access or writing some little program to do it in C Sharp or Java or whatever, would have taken a lot longer. And that's just what I've discovered from using RHEL over the last week. So this is really just the beginning of RHEL being an effective tool for this kind of desktop data manipulation. That's it. Does anyone have any questions? Excellent. Yes.
Why IBM decided to stop or develop this language?
Why did they stop developing the relational model as such? I don't know. I'd probably get a better answer from Hugh Darwen, who worked for IBM for many years and who developed the Tutorial D language specification. But my understanding is that it's primarily for commercial reasons that initially they were afraid that implementations of the relational model either wouldn't sell well or would interfere with their sales of other successful products like IBM's IMS. And then later on, once SQL had established a certain amount of market momentum, they didn't want to fight that momentum. What they wanted to do was compete by jumping on that bandwagon, so to speak. That's my impression. I might be wrong, but that's my impression.